in every home and every marriage represented here in this house. My God, I see debt cancellation descending into this place. I see financial breakthroughs. Oh, I hear so clearly. Multiplication is descending in this place. You will multiply that house of peace. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. We will make disciples. God, we thank you. The anointing of the Spirit of God is here. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. My God, I see angels descending. There are angels all across this building, all across this room. There are angels that are next to you. The angels of the Lord Almighty are here this morning. Angels are here present, ready to minister to you and I, ready to minister needs, ready to minister, my God, miracles. I don't know if you can feel it, but I feel like heaven is here. I feel like heaven is here with us this morning. Heaven is here. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Oh, heaven come. Heaven come, come. Come this morning to King Jesus. Let heaven and earth be one here in this place. Let heaven and earth be one in this altar. Let heaven and earth be one right there where you're at. Heaven is descending. Heaven is becoming one. One, 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 one. My God, Jesus, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for your blood. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood you shed on that cross of Calvary. Thank you because you paid for our sins. My God, there is redemption here this morning. There is the forgiveness of sins this morning. There's inner healing and deliverance this morning. There is breakthrough here at King Jesus this morning. Somebody listen, lift up their hands and just begin to thank God. Just begin to thank Him. Thank Him for your life. Thank Him for your health. Thank Him for the family you do have. Thank Him. Thank Him that He is in our midst. Thank Him that He is here with us. Oh, there's open heavens. There are open heavens all across this house. There are open heavens. Father, we worship you. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Can you just give them the fullness of your attention this morning? Don't let nothing intervene. Don't let nothing hinder you. Oh, don't let nothing rob you from placing your focus on Him. He's a faithful Father. He loves you. My God, I feel that the presence of God is filling us. He's filling us. He's filling us. He's filling you. He's filling me with His love. His love, the love of the Father, is here. Oh, can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel it? My God, even if you don't want it, He's giving it to you. Even if you can't comprehend it, it's over you right now. Breakthrough is over this house right now. Breakthrough is over you right now. I say breakthrough, financial breakthrough, family breakthrough, marital breakthrough, breakthrough, breakthrough. The Spirit of the Lord is here. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Somebody shout freedom. Somebody shout jubilee. Somebody shout the Father is with us this morning. Jesus is with us this morning. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord, He is here this morning. Shout, 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 come on. Can I hear a son or the daughter of God shout this morning? Oh, when you shout, you cause all of hell to get nervous. When you shout, the devil gets nervous. When you shout, heaven corresponds. Somebody lift up your voice and shout jubilee. We want to welcome everyone who's watching us over the internet. The presence of God is here. Heaven is here. And as we praise and worship, we want to invite you to just surrender, to just get crazy for God this morning. He loves you, and His love is here this morning. Amen and amen.
Yeah. just sang, he is able, he is faithful. So whatever it is that you came today waiting for, he's already here and he's able to do it. There's nothing impossible for our God. I feel that there's many of you in this place today that came and you said, I came for a healing. There's a person in this place that came and you have kidney stones. And today you came faithful saying, God, I know that you will hear me. Heal me. And in this place, in this morning, through your praise and through your worship, God is more than able to bring that healing, to bring that breakthrough to your life, to bring salvation to your life. So today we sing that what God did yesterday, he will surely do today.
Come show yourself and do it again.
Come show yourself and do it again.
Come show yourself. powers here and now, releasing signs and wonders. The earth is crying out for all the sons of God to manifest His glory. Supernatural God, Your power's here and now, releasing signs and wonders. The earth is crying out for all the sons of God to manifest Your glory. Supernatural God, Your power's here and now, releasing signs and wonders. The earth is crying out for all the sons of God to manifest Your glory. God of power, God of wonders, I will not be ashamed of You. The whole earth tells of Your glory. Come show Yourself and do it again. God of power, God of wonders, I will not be ashamed of You. The whole earth tells of Your glory. Come show Yourself and do it again.
Come show Yourself and do it again.
Come show Yourself. Your power's here and now, releasing signs and wonders. The earth is crying out for all the sons of God to manifest Your glory. Supernatural God, Your power's here and now, releasing signs and wonders. The earth is crying out for all the sons of God to manifest Your glory. Supernatural God, Your power's here and now.
I can't keep it to myself. I gotta tell somebody. his wonders. Hey! So with your praise, you're going to demonstrate this morning as an act of faith that you are believing to receive that miracle, to receive that breakthrough in this morning. Hey! So one, two, three, praise, praise!
Children, he never gets tired of healing his children. And this morning he's in this place, and I know that he hasn't finished what he started in you. And this morning there's a renewing of the mind. There's a renewing of the heart. So right there where you are, just lift up your hands. And as you make Jesus the center of your life, the center of your world, as everything begins to revolve around him, he takes control of everything in your life, of every situation.
Nothing else. center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, has always been you.
My heart to the heavens, Jesus. worship you. We honor you in this morning. It's all about you, Jesus. Come on, exalt his name. Give him praise in this morning. Give him honor in this morning. He's a wonderful God. He's a mighty God. There's no God like you, Jesus. It's all about you in this season and this month. We thank you. We thank you because you have been a wonderful God. We thank you because you have been an awesome God. Come on, praise him. Praise him. Exalt his name. Come on. And this morning, let's give him honor. Let's give him worship. He deserves the glory. He deserves the honor. Come on. Yes, Jesus. We honor you. We worship you. Come on. He is a good God. How many of you are grateful for what he has done in your life and this morning? Come on, 10 more seconds. 10 more seconds. Let's give him praise in this morning. Father, receive the worship. Receive the honor in this morning. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You may take a seat. Thank you, Jesus. As you take a seat, I want us to watch the announcement video in this morning. So if you can take a look at the screens to your left and to your right, I want us to see some announcements this morning.
Hi, King Jesus family. Let's bring you up to date with what's happening this month. Continue the cycle for the School of Disciples, New Believer and Family classes every Tuesday and Friday for the rest of the month, followed by a retreat on Saturday, November 19th. Calling everyone with a passion to share the gospel to join the evangelism ministry. They will be meeting Monday through Friday to go out and win the lost. This will be an opportunity to learn and grow in supernatural evangelism and continue transforming lives through the power of God. See you every Monday through Friday in Room 1. We are excited to let all of our friends know that on the 20th of this month, we will have a turkey giveaway. On that same day, we will be having a very special guest at our 6 p.m. service. Pastor Benny Hinn will be with us, sharing the Word of God and ministering. This is a service you cannot miss. Mark your calendars for a special Thanksgiving service for you and your family. Join us as we give thanks. For more information on classes or local events, visit our website, kingjesusmiami.org. Make sure to stop by the bookstore and check out this week's specials, as well as Apostle Guillermo Maldonado's new book, Daily Encounters with God.
Amen. Give a hand clap to the Lord for those announcements. Just for tomorrow, just for this week only, tomorrow Tabernacle will be held on Thursday. Look at your neighbor and say, Tabernacle will be this Thursday, not tomorrow. So if you come on Mondays, we will not have Tabernacle. It's going to be on Thursday. Amen? Same time, 7:30. It's just going to be Thursday, this for this week only. How many young people are here tonight? Lift up your hands. Come on, young people, you can do better than that. How many young people are here tonight? This week, this Friday, Apostle will be with us at 8 p.m., and he's going to start a new teaching on transitioning into the new. How many want the new of God? How many want transition to the new of God? So, young people, you cannot miss this Friday. It's going to be at 8 p.m. here in the temple. Amen? The children's ministry are looking for volunteers that love the children ages 2 to 12 and want to serve the children. So if you have a heart for the children, if you have a heart for ages 2 to 12 and you want to serve, and maybe you say, Pastor, right now I'm not involved in a ministry, I'm not serving in any department, we would love for you to be part of what God is doing with the new generation. Amen. So if you are interested in volunteer with the children's ministry, you can please pass by room 10, which is on my left-hand side, and they will give you more information. Amen? Next Sunday, November 20th, Apostle will begin a new series, Transitioning into the New. He will start Friday with the young people, and he will begin as well on Sunday. Amen? So we don't want you to miss out. 2 weeks ago, the evangelist department went out to the streets and won souls. How many went 2 weeks ago? Just a few, little bit? So we have a special video that we want you to see about what God did 2 weeks ago in the streets. Let's take a look.
Halloween's origin dates back to the ancient Celtic festival. It's believed that on this day, the boundary between the worlds of the living and the dead would become blurred. On the night of October 31st, they celebrated that the ghosts of the dead return to Earth. In the midst of chaos, unbelief, deception, and darkness, 220 evangelists went out with the light of the Father, the gospel, and the supernatural power of God.
But there's been predicaments where you're just like, yo,
Elisha, I heard that name. That was yours?
Oh, God.
No.
Stay.
Lord, as my Lord,
as my Savior,
as my Savior,
I renounce
any covenant.
The clash of two kingdoms was evident as we covered multiple areas in the city of Miami.
I see two letters. I see like a P and an R. Is there someone that you, that oh, like a
P and an R.
Oh, oh my God.
Who is that?
17.
Who is that?
I and Ramon.
No. Okay.
It was crazy how like they gave me initials of like people that have hurt me and stuff, and they don't even know me. It's P and R, and those are like two, like different names. Like one is P, one is R. Different names of like people that have hurt me.
I really wasn't expecting for this to happen, and especially on Halloween, since it's kind of Halloween is kind of the opposite of Christ if you think about it. And it was just very surprising and interesting.
There was someone that did you wrong. I see like a betrayal, and I see God, you know, blessing you and
hey,
also
boy,
healing.
You just sold a mouth for it, boy.
Yeah.
Nigga just did that. My best friend, who yeah. I grew up with all my life, my neighbor. You betrayed me 2 days ago.
Man, I don't know if there's like a close friend or like a family
a close
member
friend.
with a name that starts with a letter B.
I'm gone.
Oh, I'm gone. Oh,
go. What's the B? What's the
Barfield? Jesus.
Say Jesus.
Right, Jesus.
Forgive me.
Of my sins.
I know I've sinned. I've made mistakes.
But by faith.
I give you my life.
And every body part that needs healing.
Yes.
Father, we're doing this for your glory. At the count of three, Jesus, we yes. declare your healing power manifest. In Jesus' name, 1, 2, and 3.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Hey. Oh, what happened to your pain?
Still there?
Honestly, tell me.
I ain't gonna even lie, mine's gone. I swear to God.
Come on, what happened?
I swear to God, I don't got no pain right here no more.
Come on. You see them standing together, right? Okay, check this out. Follow my instructions, and when you stand up, you're gonna be his height. Okay, everybody sees that they're not the same height, right? I don't got nothing in my sleeves, right? All right. Okay, so Tyrell, you're gonna squat down like this. His legs, and you make them the same height as this young man at the count of three. 1, 2, 3, in Jesus' name. Look at that. Everyone saw that.
What do you feel?
It's gone. It's gone.
We speak to the muscles. We declare the lines. Father, my God, you begin, Father, my God, to create what needs to be created. You begin to put together with
foot. What happened to your foot? You cracked it. And you couldn't put pressure.
I see, I don't know if it's like designing or something is like that, but I just see you having a creative mind, you know?
It's true, but he doesn't know you.
There's something wrong with someone in your family. I don't know if it's like either depression or something, and it's a type of sickness. Who is that person? Your nephew?
He has autism, but at the same time it's a level, like it's a high level, and then it's really close to me.
What if I tell you that I've seen people getting healed from autism?
because the power of God is real. I send the word, my God, of healing, restoration, my God, to her family.
I see a lot of rejection. I see that people have rejected you, and I see that people have not appreciated your hard work. I see you work very hard for a lot of people. Do you have kids? You have one kid. I see that you work very hard, a lot, and I see that there's pain in your heart from past betrayal that you still hold, and it's been very hard for you.
Do you know anybody named Chantel, something like that? Who's that? Who's that person?
That's my friend.
That's your friend? Is she a close friend to you? Yeah, I just heard.
19 years.
Yeah, for 19 years. I just saw the name. I just saw the name, and I feel that she. Yeah, I just saw the name right now. More of God, my God, feel her. Feel her with your presence. Feel her with your presence, my God, in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, give her more. Give her more. Give her more. Now, when I pray for you, I want you to open your mouth. I don't want you to reason it. I want you to say what God is releasing upon your mouth right now. It's not going to be a language you're going to understand. It's the Holy Spirit. It's going to baptize you right now. Are you ready? Let's do it together. Give me your hand. Father, in Jesus' name, I declare right now in the count of three, a baptism of the Holy Spirit upon your daughter. In Jesus' name. One, two, three, now.
You know, me and my girl, we were going through a lot the last year, especially her. You know, and you guys were saying the right things. You guys were right on the nose, saying exactly what she was going through. And I feel like you guys really helped her out with something. You helped her move past something tonight.
Powerful, like it was like something in me, like,
it's amazing, huh?
Yes.
Everything he said to me was real. So it's amazing. The life story he told to me, it was real. So it was no one but God. And all these people, I felt the power of God.
Do you feel like recommitted to God?
Yes, I do.
On this night, over 1,239 souls confessed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. An invasion of creative miracles, accurate prophetic words, and the manifestation of the love of the Father pierced right through the hearts. What was supposed to be a celebration of the dead turned into a harvest of souls.
Come on, you can give the Lord a big hand for them. 1,239 souls saved on Halloween. Come on, young people. Come on, adults. Everybody in this building, let's give a hand clap to the Lord, because God is bringing the supernatural power of God in this city. That night, souls were won. People were delivered. People were healed. People were speaking in tongues. People were transformed by the power of the living God. Wow, I'm excited. That's amazing. Wow, praise God. So last week we saw what God did in Argentina. How many of you were touched and blessed by the video we saw last week of Argentina? Not only Apostle was in Argentina, but he also visited Chile. Amen. So this morning we want you to watch what God did in Chile. Amen. So I want you to take a look at this video.
Yo profetizo un derramar del Espíritu Santo en Chile. Viene una nueva era. Viene un nuevo tiempo sobre la iglesia de Jesucristo. Viene un derramar del Espíritu Santo, lo cual esta tierra jamás ha visto.
Embraced by breathtaking mountain ranges and the Pacific Ocean, this country is the longest and narrowest country in the world. Chile. A land of splendid and extreme landscapes. A wonder that distracts you from the needs of its people. Over one century ago, Chile experienced its first spiritual revival with the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. But as time went by, intellectualism started taking over. And in many congregations, tradition and religion replaced the power of God. God says in his word that he will complete the work he has begun. So God began his plan to lift up sons and daughters hungry for his presence that would bring revival back to this country. In October 2016, Apostle Guillermo Maldonado visited Chile with the purpose of imparting and activating a country and a generation in God's supernatural power. He brought a fresh rhema word to the church's leadership and to the body of Christ as a whole. In Santiago, Chile, Apostle Maldonado participated in the consecration of the new temple for the church, Cristo tu única esperanza. Led by his spiritual children, pastors Fernando and Jessica Chaparro. This new temple, with seating for 5,000 people, is a living testimony of how God is expanding his kingdom and accelerating the times in Chile.
Señor, dedicamos esta casa, la consagramos y la separamos para tu servicio. Este lugar será solamente para adorar, para orar y exaltarte a ti. Que siempre tu presencia esté, nunca la parte de este lugar. Padre, muchas gracias. Declaramos tu casa consagrada, dedicada para tu uso exclusivo y para tu presencia.
Apostle Maldonado came to Chile with the assignment to prepare the church for the outpouring of God's new wine. He taught the people how to tear down mental strongholds, reminding us that the manifestation of miracles, signs, and wonders is the seal of God's approval.
Hay una ola de milagros creativos. Dios creando huesos, carne, y todo lo que hace falta en tu pueblo. Confirma y afirma que Cristo está vivo. Padre, a la cuenta de tres, ato todo espíritu de enfermedad. Se va de esos cuerpos. ¡Ahora!
Laura tiene 11 años. Ellos son sus padres. Su hígado no le estaba funcionando. El médico dijo que había que hacerle un trasplante. El hígado, cuando no está bien, hace que el vaso se ponga grande. Ella vino aquí con dolor. Ella no podía saltar. Dice que cuando empezaron a orar por ella sintió el fuego de Dios y ahora puede saltar, se le fue el dolor completamente.
¡Wow! Dios crea un hígado en Santiago de Chile.
Cuando era niño, a los 14 años me operaron y me sacaron las dos costillas. Entonces usted dijo que en una campaña, en una cruzada, había un hombre que le habían salido dos costillas y una doctora le tocó. Entonces yo escuché eso, le dije a mi esposa, ora, porque eso es para mí. Y ella empezó a orar y esa palabra de ciencia. Y después me empecé a tocar y empecé a ver
¿a que estaba... ¿A dónde te hacían falta?
Aquí.
¿Que te sentías que estaba hueco?
No, no tenía, porque lo tenía hueco. No tenía las dos costillas, pero ahora las tengo. Apóstol, tóquela, tóquela.
¿Qué te dijeron los médicos, hija?
Que tenía que hacer un trasplante. Era lo único.
En otras palabras, necesitabas un pulmón nuevo.
Los dos.
¿Los dos?
Sí.
¿Cómo sabes que estás sana? ¿Cuánto tiempo has estado con este coso?
2 años.
2 años.
Sí.
¿Y ellos te dijeron la única forma?
Sí, la única
es un trasplante.
Trasplante.
Arrancarte el viejo y ponerte uno nuevo.
Sí.
¿Qué pasó hoy?
Ahora cuando llamaron por sanidad, vine hacia adelante y empecé a sentir un calor. Un calor, calor, calor. Todavía lo siento acá.
¿Y puedes respirar? ¿Qué no podías hacer? ¿Te desconectaste?
Sí, tenía que estar a las 24 horas con dormir con eso, todo con eso. No podía hacer nada.
Y ahora puedes correr, sí. Puedes darle. ¡Póngase de pie! ¡Póngase de pie! Dios le acaba de crear dos pulmones nuevos.
There were 81 documented miracles that day.
of which 15 were creative miracles. These powerful testimonies were only the beginning of what God had prepared for Chile during this encounter. From Santiago, we traveled to Iquique, the land of champions, where 3,000 people came from all over Chile, Brazil, Peru, and all of South America came together to allow God's power to transform their lives and their mentalities.
Ha llegado tu día, Chile, ha llegado tu momento.
Creemos que habrá un gran rompimiento.
Y creemos que Dios va a hacer milagros, maravillas y señales.
Creemos que viene un avivamiento poderoso en este país.
Va a marcar nuestra vida para lo que viene en esta próxima temporada.
Sabemos lo que el apóstol Maldonado trae para Chile. Creemos que tiene un avivamiento sobrenatural muy grande.
Nosotros creemos que se va a provocar un rompimiento en el mundo espiritual.
Once in Iquique, Apostle Maldonado joined Pastors Felix and Alicia Orquera from Jesus es el Rey Church, who hosted the supernatural encounter in their city. Continuing to move in his mandate, Apostle Maldonado taught about the end times anointing and the purpose of faith to experience heaven on earth, empowering them with God's Rhema word to sustain revival.
Ya no podemos vivir del avivamiento pasado. Ya no podemos vivir de los enfermos que se sanaron ayer. Tenemos que vivir de lo que el Espíritu está diciendo. Sale la rema que sale de lo que el Espíritu de Dios dice a la iglesia. Eso va a causar una aceleración en tu negocio, en el trabajo, en lo que iba a tomarte años, te va a tomar meses. Eso es lo que está diciendo el Espíritu de Dios.
The Rhema came to life and activated something in all of those who were hungry for God's fresh revelation. The kingdom of God began establishing itself in the minds, hearts, and bodies of those present, and the kingdom of darkness was being destroyed.
Ato todo espíritu de enfermedad se va de esos cuerpos. Desato un río y una ola de milagros creativos. Crea retinas, crea huesos, crea costillas. 1, 2, 3, ¡ahora!
Ella fue a CAP en el 2014, María Soledad. Mientras estaban hablando de un pacto, el Señor le habla a ella y le dice: siembra todo lo que tú has lo que tú tienes en el banco que traías. Todo, quédate sin nada. Ella dice: yo le creí a Dios y lo sembré. Hoy en día, Pastor Ernesto tiene una compañía de $1,000,000 y 5,000 personas bajo ella. 2 años después.
Y cuéntame, cuéntame.
Yo fui en el 2014 al CAP y Dios me dijo en mi oído: todo, todo lo que tengas en el banco, todo me lo dejas acá. Porque yo, hija, te voy a prosperar.
Eso toma
y
fe.
2 años después el Señor hizo un rompimiento tremendo. Empezamos a formar la empresa. La empresa se creó por $1,000,000. Yo era curandera, espiritista, chamana, pero le creí a Dios, que es un Dios de poder. Porque él dice que está en los
ángeles. ¿Sabe qué prueba esto? Que la prosperidad del reino es mejor que la prosperidad de las tinieblas. Esta mujer fue diagnosticada con fibrosis pulmonar. Esa enfermedad no tiene cura. Los doctores le habían dicho que necesitaba un trasplante de pulmón. Ella me cuenta que lleva 2 semanas esputando sangre.
Uy.
Pero cuando usted dio la palabra, ella sintió un fuego en el pulmón. Y usted dijo que habían personas acá que iban a recibir pulmones nuevos. Y ella, en un acto de fe, hizo un esputo y por primera vez no hubo sangre, hubo saliva.
Le habían dicho
hecho trasplante.
No, trasplante. Si no hay otra solución, tuve un mes hospitalizada.
¿Y qué pasó?
El pastor subió y empezó a orar y sentí su mano caliente. Y en este codo igual, porque tenía artritis.
¿Y entonces vomitaste y vomitaba sangre?
Sí, yo tosía y tosía sangre.
Uy.
Y ahora tosí y me salía pura saliva.
Eso significa que Dios te creó pulmón.
¡Amén!
¡Corre, dale, dale, dale!
Scarlett nació con un desgaste en las dos retinas de los ojos. Apenas miraba con un ojo un poquito. Ella es la doctora de ojos y ella sabe todo lo que ha pasado.
Cuéntame, explícame, hija.
Ella veía muy poco de muy cerquita, porque le inducía a una miopía, solo cerquita podía ver. Ahora la tomamos, le tomé la visión a 5 metros y ella me vio y me dijo todo lo que le dio. El Señor le creó nuevas retinas.
Mamá, no veo, ni incluso con mis lentes no veo. Yo le decía, hija, Dios va a hacerlo. El apóstol viene a Chile y Dios lo va a hacer, así que prepárate. Y me dice, mamá, ahora veo bien. Mamita, veo todo claro.
Cuéntame, ¿qué sientes? ¿Qué sientes, hija?
Veo todo claro, antes no podía ver. Y ahora veo todo bien, todo claro. Incluso ella me puso de allá y yo veo todo bien. Antes tenía que esforzarme demasiado para ver y ahora veo.
¡Un aplauso, por favor!
El Señor me sanó hoy en el encuentro sobrenatural y tuve un milagro que el Señor me hizo hoy día en las piernas, que yo no podía correr, no podía saltar, no podía hacer nada.
Aarón tiene 8 años. Él se cayó y debido a eso le cayó un virus que se llama Pertes. Ese virus se come los huesos. Se le había comido todas las caderas aquí. Debido a eso le hicieron una operación y le pusieron puros metales. Él caminaba torcido. Cuando llegó aquí caminaba torcido y él ahora va a decir, ¿cómo lo hace? ¿Cómo lo hace ahora? No podía saltar. Dice que cuando usted dijo, recibe ahora, este es el abuelo y es testigo de lo que está diciendo. Dice que sintió un fuego y inmediatamente fue sano, se cayó al piso y está caminando bien. Le puso una cadera nueva.
Cuéntame tú mejor, tú eres un predicador.
Me come el hueso que yo tengo en el fémur. Me come todo ese hueso y yo no puedo caminar.
¿Cómo caminabas, hijo? Ahora y ahora.
Yo no podía caminar, no podía hacer nada. Y entonces ahora que oraron por mí, me sentí un fuego y me caí al piso. Ahora camino bien. Y después, antes yo no podía correr, no podía saltar, no podía hacer absolutamente nada. Y ahora puedo caminar bien y puedo hacer algo que antes no podía hacer. Y ese encuentro sobrenatural, le doy muchas gracias al Señor. Amén.
God healed his people. The atmosphere was saturated with worship as the Chilean people cried out and yielded to the Holy Spirit. Responding to their cries, God manifested first as the gentle comforter who heals, and later as a wave of fire transforming their hearts.
Lo que hoy estoy sintiendo, lo que hoy estoy viviendo, jamás lo había experimentado en mi vida. Señor, me sanó de fibromialgia durante 5 años.
He estado muchos años con una carga emocional y he sido liberada en este encuentro sobrenatural.
Sentí un peso de gloria, sentí toda la presencia de Dios.
Hace 10 años perdí mi oído izquierdo por una otitis mal cuidada y hoy día recuperé mi oído, escucho todo, estoy feliz. Solo el ovario me dio el órgano del ovario y las trompas de Falopio.
Me liberé, me siento libre, ahora me siento contenta.
Y hace 7 años me diagnosticaron un Parkinson, pero hoy día Dios me sanó, me puso neuronas nuevas y me sanó.
Fue un encuentro con la presencia de Dios que nunca antes había sentido, un encuentro con el Espíritu Santo.
The purpose of God for Chile was not delayed. God proved his love and majesty in all its splendor.
manifesting heaven on earth, healing the hearts and the bodies of his sons and daughters. Over 7,000 people, most of them church leaders, witnessed his wonderful outpouring of love. 61 people gave their hearts to Christ for him to reign as king of their lives. There were 308 documented testimonies, 67 of which were creative miracles of all kinds. God created organs. He created bones, new ribs, new tissue. The impossible became possible in a matter of seconds in the presence of God. Chile experienced an end-time revival that will change the history of this nation forever. Chile experienced a supernatural encounter.
Let's worship. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. lift your hands toward Jesus. We're going to shift the atmosphere. How do you shift the atmosphere? You start praying in tongues out loud. You start worshiping in tongues out loud. All the musicians. Sharabokota rabashita rabakate rebeshira. Yebro shirabarate kishtik rando shirabara. Celebrate who shirabakashe. Yobribata stik roboshe rabashire. Yerebeke stik rabashe rabashe. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Sharebroto shirabaka. Varishta granda shirabrosha. Jesus, we declare your lordship. We declare that you are God. We declare, Holy Spirit, reveal the truth to your people. Holy Spirit, reveal the truth to your people. Holy Spirit, bring Jesus. We welcome you. We thank you. We acknowledge your presence. We acknowledge that you're here to reveal the truth, to reveal Jesus, to reveal the Father. I thank you. I worship you, Father. I give you praise. Shirobrunda sharabanda. Come on, lift, shift the atmosphere. Don't be an spectator. Get involved in the service. You know, when you come into the service, you come to worship. Don't be an spectator. Just watch it around. What's happening? God wants to touch you. God wants to touch your body. God wants to touch your spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I can hear the people praying. Sharebrindo sola branda, siterebekeste granda. Say thank you, Lord Jesus. To you be the praise, Lord. To you be the honor. To you be the worship. We declare this is the day that the Lord has made, and we rejoice in it. In Jesus' mighty name, I thank you, Lord. Can you put your hand together, people? Can you put your hand together? You know something? I know everyone, you can go through crisis and things in life, but I want you to learn to overcome. I want you to learn to, in the middle of what you're going through, you need to lift your hands. I don't like to see the people so passive. You need to raise your hands. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You need to shout. You need to be free. Where the Spirit of God is, there's liberty. I said, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. This is not a funeral home church. This is not the house of men church. This is the house of God. You need to say, thank you, Lord. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You need to make a decision. You need to say, the joy of the Lord is my strength, and I will rejoice in it. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter. Come on, in Jesus' name. I want you to come out from your seat. Say hello to three people. Give them a big hand. Tell them I love you. Rejoice in the Lord. Come on. Yes, Lord. Amen. All right. Take your seat. Thank you. Take your seat. Oh, Lord Jesus. Smile to the person next to you. Tell him you look so handsome this morning. You're very anointed. You know the word grace, one of the meanings of the word grace means irresistible. When you have the grace, have you seen those people and you said, I love this person, I don't know. They never give me a gift, but I love them. There's something in them. That is the grace of God. I want you to turn around and tell them, I have the grace of God on me. Oh my God. You go and knock the door and they said, who are you? Say, well, wait a minute. You got something. You're irresistible. They can say no to you. Touch your neighbor and tell they can say no to me. You got the grace of God. Can you put your hand together, people? Isn't that awesome to be in the house of God this morning? I said, isn't that awesome? The Bible said you don't walk by sight. You walk by faith, meaning sight means feeling, senses. And sometimes you feel like, have you been in that place you feel very bad? And you said, man, God, I feel tired. But just don't go by the senses. Don't go by what you feel. You need to go by faith. And what do you go by faith? You go say, God, there's a greater reality of what I'm experiencing now. But you need to smile and shout and come on, give him a big praise. Thank you, Lord. Say, thank you, Lord. Christianity is not bored, you know. It's like boring Christianity. Like, oh my God, brother, how you doing, brother? I don't know. I'm going through trials and tribulations. And okay, we all go through trials and tribulations, but the Bible says rejoice, rejoice. Touch your neighbor and tell him rejoice. Change your face. Come on. I need to prepare you for the message that we'll bring this morning. I need to prepare you for this message that I'll bring this morning. Okay. I want you to open the scriptures, and I'm going to speak to you this morning on the message, contending for the truth. Contending for the truth. I want you to say it with me. No, but that you sound like Catholic like that. Come on, lift your hand and say it. Come on, one, two, three. Okay. What do you mean you have to contend for the truth? I remember when we had CAP, the Holy Spirit said to me, the hurricane was coming, a lot of things were happening, and the Lord said, son, you need to contend for CAP. And I know what the Lord meant when he said to me, you need to contend. There are things in life that will come to you. They will come to you by grace, and you don't have to fight for it. They just, God will give them to you. But there's some other things in life that you need to contend for. You need to fight. Now, you don't sound like you want to fight this morning. Okay, you need to fight. Okay, how do you explain what the Bible says? In one verse, the Bible says, you have to come to God as a little child, and you need to receive those things as a little child. That means a child, you don't have to fight. But in another verse, the Bible says, the violent take it by force. And they say, wait a minute, do I stay a little child? Well, think when things don't come to you, and it's hard because the enemy will stop it. You have to fight, my brother. Touch your neighbor and tell him, hey, you have to fight. And when do you fight and when do you receive things? That's what we need to discern. But this morning we're going to contend and we're going to fight for the truth. So I want you to go to the scriptures in John chapter 18, verse 38. And I want to welcome all the people that are watching by the internet and all the people that are watching and the supernatural now. Can you put your hand together? We welcome all the people contending for the truth. John 18, 38. Pilate said to him, to who? To Jesus, what is truth? And that question is a lot of people still asking today. What is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jewish and said to them, I have no fault in him at all. So Pilate asked, what is truth? Touch your neighbor and tell him, what is truth? You sound very Catholic this morning. Come on, say it. What is truth? Okay. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 24, verse 3, 4, and 5. What is truth? He asked, what is truth? He knew what truth was. What happened is he went and washed his hands to do what he wanted. The truth was in front of him. Truth was there. But he didn't want to know the truth. He rejected the truth. So sometimes we got the truth in front of us and we reject it. So he knew the truth. And he said, for many will come in my name, saying, I am Christ. And underline that word, and will deceive many. That's the first verse in Matthew 24, the signs of the end time. One of the signs of the end time that Jesus mentioned three times is deception. Three times. So number five, and then he said, for many will be in the four. I would say first, first, and then 24, four, first. Jesus answered to them, take heed that no one deceives you. Verse five. And then he mentioned again, for many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and will be deceive many. So you'll see three times. In another verse, he mentions three times that will be deceived. There will be deception. So it's one of the end time signs. Deception, deceive. So he asked for truth. I want you to go now in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. For many will come. I'm sorry. You need to run over there, guys. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. And then he said, can you check? So I want you to go, please, something that what Jesus mentioned, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. And if you have the Bible, you read it. What's wrong, Eddie Puerta? For you remember, brethren, our labor. No, that's not the verse. Verse 11, verse 10. 2 Thessalonians, not 1 Thessalonians. Can you remove the person of the coming of lawlessness? One is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Verse 10. And with all unrighteous deception, talking about the Antichrist. Those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they may be saved. Verse 11. For this reason, God will send them, not the devil. God will send them, who are them, those that rejects the truth. Those that they don't want to know the truth about yourself. There are people always having excuses not to change. People always giving excuses to be in the misery that they live in right now, and they don't want to accept the truth. I can preach a very nice message, and they don't want to receive it because they don't want the truth. So, and then he said, God will send them. Who are them? Those that reject the truth. It's not going to be the devil. It will be God. Will send them a strong. And then he said, for this reason, God will send them a strong delusion. Another verse says, spirit of deception, that they should believe the lie. What he's saying is, before a person is deceived First, that person had an opportunity to receive the truth but rejected. And when they rejected, then God said, I will send a spirit of delusion, spirit of deception, and then you will believe a lie. So that person had that opportunity, and they rejected. So he said that it should believe a lie. So these are the times that we're living in that you cannot. We're living in times of deception. We're living in times of lies. Lying is normal. As a matter of fact, this is the order that you see how the truth. First, people compromised the truth. After you compromise the truth, you suppress the truth. When I go ahead in the message, I will explain to you how the people now, why people are being deceived. Why people are being deceived? Because first they rejected the truth. Okay, let me mention to you John chapter 6, verse 54. John chapter 6, verse 54. And you will see something very important. Okay, John chapter 6, verse 54. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up in the last day. That is the way to say, whoever is totally committed to me. That's the way to say it. And in modern terms, whoever is totally committed to me. He said, I will raise it. Verse 55. In other words, he's talking about commitment. He's talking about making a covenant with God. I will serve you, God. I'm committed to you. He said, whoever drinks my blood, whoever eats my flesh, is totally committed to me. That's another way to say it. My flesh is food indeed. My blood is drink. He was not talking about eating blood, the natural blood, like blood. He was talking about being committed. Verse 56. And then he said, he who eats my flesh and drink my blood abides in me and in him. Verse 56, 7. Keep going quickly. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father who feeds me, on me will live because of me. Verse 58. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as the fathers hath manna in our deed. He who eats the bread will live forever. Verse 59. And these things he said in the synagogue, he taught in Capernaum. Verse 60. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, when they heard, why? It's like me standing here and say, okay, you need to be totally committed to this ministry and you don't have another choice. You say, wait a minute, I got things to do in my house. This man want me to be committed here? No, I can't. So he went asking for commitment. You will check the heart of the people when you ask for commitment. Not only in the church, but I'm asking commitment to prayer, commitment to God, commitment to give, commitment to serve, commitment to God brought you into this ministry to be committed. Amen. See, there's very less amen because, you know, as you saw. So that's what Jesus said. Okay, I come to you, disciples, and then he said, you must be committed. That's another way to say it. Eat my body and drink my flesh. And then he said, drink my blood. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? Keep going. Who can understand it? And then he said, when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, thus these offend you? Asking you commitment, total commitment to me offend you? What I'm saying to you is the gospel, the truth, will offend people. One amen. The rest of the people, in other words, this is where the secret friendly church comes in. When you're trying to please people, when you're trying to not to offend people, you become in the category of secret friendly. Okay, do not say this, do not say that, or do not say this. Wait a minute. I cannot avoid to speak the truth, and the truth will not offend people. Put your hands together. Come on. Okay, the moment I try to please you, not God, I will become men's pleaser. So you choose. In other words, I will see people when I preach truth being offended. I have seen it last service, the last two Sundays, when I was preaching on standing on our values. I got people that got up and left. My question to you is this, and you, my sons and daughters, if you're watching, this is the question I'm asking you. Is your loyalty more to a political party or your loyalty to Jesus and to this house? Oh, I wish I can hear a big amen on that. I can't hear it. In other words, is your loyalty to this house that has changed your heart? Is your loyalty to this, to me, and to Jesus that has delivered you, healed you, touched you, changed your family, and what the political party has not done anything for you? Come on, put your hand together. I was very clear last Sunday. And at 11 o'clock, many of my Spanish sons and daughters got up and left. As a pastor, do I like that? No. They're my sons. I don't want them to leave. But I'm sorry, I can't avoid it, and I will never compromise the truth. If you want a pastor as men's pleaser, but let me tell you what happened. When you please men, the Spirit of God will lift from this ministry. I have seen pastors that went very political. That's the spirit of Herod. That's the leaven of Herod. When we become so political, in which way? We try to please people. I stood here and I stood on values. If one of the candidates has some values that I believe in the Bible, I will go for that candidate. Can you put your hand together? So, unfortunately, when you speak the truth, when you talk the truth, people will offend. And I'm sorry if they get offended. I am so sorry. But let me tell you something. The truth never apologizes. The truth never apologizes. The truth never apologizes. We need a gospel of the truth. I want somebody to tell me the truth. I don't want to be in a lie. I want somebody to tell me to stand and contend for the truth. I want somebody to say, wait a minute, the truth is that I'm not committed. The truth is that I'm not serving God. The truth is that I'm not committed to Jesus. The truth is I will need to change my heart and stand on the truth. It doesn't matter if it's against my family. It doesn't matter if it's against the people. It doesn't matter. I will stand on truth. I will stand on value. The truth, the truth, the truth, the truth never apologizes. Somebody have to shout it. Touch your neighbor and tell them, don't apologize for saying the truth. Take your seat. Oh my God. Oh my God. I need the musicians. Oh my God. Oh my God! Do you want a man pleaser? Do you want a man pleaser? If you do, the Spirit of God will lift from the church. We're not going to have power. We're not going to have presence. Why? Because when you please man, you're not going to please God. Oh, Jesus. Touch your neighbor and tell him, are they talking to you or are they talking to me? Oh, Jesus. So he said, when you reject the truth, many will be offended. Many will be offended. They said, oh my God, this guy is asking me to be committed. And they start leaving. They start leaving. I ask you to be committed to values. I ask you to stand on truth. Isn't what I asked you last Sunday? Can I hear an amen, people? Let me tell you what happened. Let me tell you what happened, and I'm going to go with this. Truth today, the first step when you see people preaching the truth, say with me, truth.
Truth.
This is just the introduction. Just the introduction. Truth. Say with me, truth.
Truth.
So when you see people preaching the truth, you will see in that ministry, you will see reality. In other words, you don't see fake people. You see reality, because that's what truth is. It's reality. But listen to this. But the moment I compromise truth, first I suppress truth. Suppress truth means that I can go to you and say, I can't say this because this family will get offended. I can't say this because this person will get offended. I can't say this, and I'm always suppressing truth, not to tell the people what is the truth. What happened is, the moment you suppress it, the second step is you compromise truth. When you compromise truth, the judgment for it is the Spirit of God lifts from you. And one of the greatest fear of Jesus, David, and all the men of God was, please do not remove your spirit. Do not remove your presence. People think, I compromise and nothing happened. Don't lie about your income taxes. Don't lie about your job. Don't lie about your age. A lot of people lying for everything. Oh, shit, Araba. Lying for everything. Lying in mentors. Lying in disciples. Lying. They lying in. Let me go on the other side. They lying in every. How old are you? I'm 25. No, you're 30. How old are you? I'm 50. No, I'm 60. No, you're 60. You're lying. So there's a spirit of lie in the church, and it's normal. Lie is normal in the church. You need to repent. Stop lying. I said, stop lying. God will not bless you. If you want reality, you need to stop lying. Shambre Heshita. Somebody have to shout. Do you want a pastor to stand here and tell you a lie? Don't you able to tell him, contend for the truth. Take your seat. Take your seat. Come on. This is just the introduction. We live in a world of deception. Everything is about deception. Everything is about lying. Truth is not popular. It's the end time sign. It's the end time. Because truth is not, people get offended. But I'm sorry, the gospel will offend people. Jesus said something very powerful. He said, even in your own house, you will have fight. Why? Because people will not agree with you, but you always stay in the side of truth. Can I hear an amen, people? Okay, so what is truth? Let's go. What is truth? What is truth? Truth is not the opinion of people. What is truth? Let's go. Let's go. Let's get the definition of truth. And I want you to write it down, because I want you as a believer to be founded, to be established on the truth. I want you to be established on the truth. If I give the message a subtitle, it will be to be established on truth, on the truth. What is truth? Truth, I want you to write it down, please. Truth is a person. Truth cannot be less than a person. Truth is the person of Jesus. John 14:6. Let's go. John 14:6. You will see that truth is the person of Jesus Christ. In other words, if it's less than a person, it's not the truth. It's something abstract. It's something that doesn't have substance. It's not real. It has to be a person. Okay, Jesus said to them, I am the way, the truth. I'm giving you the verses. I'm giving you the foundation in the Bible. Okay, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. In other words, lift your hands and say, Jesus is the truth. Jesus. Say it louder, come on. Jesus. Is Jesus a person? Yes. Come on, Jesus a person?
Yes.
Shout it, yes.
Yes.
Truth is not an abstract. So the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. John 16:13. So we speak about the truth. What is truth? It's a person. John 16:13. You need to go faster, guys, over there. John 16:13. However, when the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you in all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. Do you want to know the truth about you? Do you want to know the truth about if that person loves you or not? Do you want to know about the truth about the elections? Do you want to know the truth about anything? Go to the Holy Spirit. He lives inside of you, and he can tell you what is the truth. You got the witness inside of you, and you said, I cannot explain it, but I know that's the truth. Somebody have to say amen to that. So Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. So the Word is the truth. John 17:17. The Word is the truth. Say it. The Word is the truth. Sanctify them by your truth. Your Word is truth. What do you mean? Do you believe the Word of God is the absolute truth? No, no, but you need to, this is not the Quran. Okay, I'll say it again. Do you believe the Word of God is from Genesis to Revelation the truth?
Yes.
Lift your hand, say it.
Yes.
Man, do the Pledge of Allegiance to the Word of God. Say it with me. It's the absolute truth.
Yes.
You sound like Baptist. Before it was Catholic, now you're a little better. You sound like Baptist. Come on, say it. Lift your hands. The Word of God.
Yes.
Bring me the scripture. The Word of God. It's the absolute truth. No, 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 like this. Lift your hands and say, you pledge the pledge of the legion to the scripture. Get the scripture, son. The scripture, the Bible. The Bible. You know the scripture? Lift your hands and say it. The Bible. It's the absolute truth. Come on, say it. Say the Bible, the scripture is the absolute truth. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Do you believe it?
Yes.
Do you believe it from Genesis to Revelation?
Yes.
Why do you believe the lies of the enemy? Why do you believe more the opinions of people more than the Word of God? Why then you choose? Oh, Sharabato. Why? Do you believe this is the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation, inspired by the Holy Spirit? Why do you believe a lie? Touch your neighbor and tell him, why? Take your seat. And then you go. Lift your hands and say, the Word of God is the truth. Absolute truth. Okay, so we see that the Word, Jesus and the Holy Spirit are a person. So that's the truth. The truth is a person. The truth. So in order for us to have basis for reality, We need to be founded, to be established in something, which is in the scripture. We cannot allow to give our opinion. Sometimes we choose somebody else's opinion above the scriptures. But pastor, but the scripture says, though, remember, if you have any doubt in the Bible on some scriptures, go to the Holy Spirit. He's the Spirit of truth. He will tell you exactly. Can I hear an amen for that? Okay. Truth, write it down. Under the definition of truth, truth is what causes. Truth causes a thing to be. Causes a thing to be. What do you mean? Without the truth, nothing can be created. Without the truth, nothing can be real. Without the truth, in other words, for something to exist, there has to be truth behind it. If they don't have that backup of truth, listen to me. Sometimes we've been accused. Sometimes we're being persecuted. Truth never defends itself. Why? Because truth defends is in his own, its own self. So truth, in the middle of the world that is lying and in deception, we lie for everything. And it's normal. We became desensitized. We see people being killed. And today was, oh my God, it's a war. Now it's normal. Our spirit became so desensitized because we've been rejecting the truth. The Bible says, listen to this, so truth is what causes the things to be. So the question is, this is the question. Another definition of truth. I'm not just staying in the truth because I want you to be established on the truth. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. Truth is the highest type of reality above the five senses. I want you to write it down. Truth is the highest type of reality above the five senses. Above, oh my God, it's the highest type of reality above the five senses. What do you mean? You mean, this is crazy. Having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. But we have a lot of friends. We have a lot of people. We got fellowship. A lot of people, those kind of people. Who are those people? Let me tell you this. Having a form of reality, of godliness, but denying its power. That translation, form of godliness, write it down, means. I want you to write it down what it means. Means something that has no relation to reality. Something that has no relation to reality. What do you mean, Apostle? Meaning that when somebody, the truth is absence in a person. If you're always lying, you got a form of God that has no relation to reality. Wow. Meaning, without the truth backing you up, without living the truth, you just have a form of God. God is absence in you. That is very powerful. Meaning what? Meaning something that has no relation to reality. In other words, there's nothing real when truth is not in your mouth. There's nothing real when truth is not in your heart. There's nothing real. What do you have then? You just got to form something that has no power because in order for power to manifest, truth has to be said. No, man, no, you don't understand what I'm saying. In other words, it's above the beyond the five senses. It's a reality because it's a person. Can I hear an amen, people? Amen. So it's a form, it's a deception. There's no power to change. There's no power to deliver. There's no power to transform people. In other words, I want to make sure when I'm preaching the truth, because if I don't, if I'm preaching my opinion, nothing will change you. Nothing will change you. Nothing will deliver you. Nothing will set you free. I have to speak the truth. That's why you have to love the truth. When you love the truth, God, the truth will set you free. If you keep hearing the same thing that is an opinion of men, what happened is there's a appearance. There's nothing to relation to reality, my God. My God, touch your neighbor and tell him, I want reality. Take your seat, come on. Shout it, lift your hands and say, I want reality. No. You need to say it like better than that. I want reality. What do you mean? What do you mean? Okay, it's the highest type of reality. Above the five senses. This is what happened. When someone speaks the truth, says the truth to someone, tell the truth. When you do that, you're talking about reality. You're talking about reality. Something is real. But there's some people, they're so deceived. When truth comes to you, you accuse people of being false prophet and apostle because they're speaking the truth. Can I hear an amen, people? In other words, because we don't want to hear truth. Okay, listen. The truth offends you. Yes. Unfortunately, it will offend you. There's truth about yourself. There's truth about your business. There's truth, and you have to confront it. And say, I'm sorry, but there's a truth. I need to lose weight. See, the amen went down. I'm sorry, but I can't keep doing business the way I'm doing. I'm lying. I have to stop it. Let me go on the other side. I'm sorry, but I want something real. Because you keep on the emotions and nothing changes in your life because the truth is not in you. When truth is in you, things are being changed. Things are being delivered. Business are being... Something is happening to your business because you walk with the truth. Say the truth. Always, even it will cost you millions and millions of dollars, say the truth. Always, 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 always. Somebody have to shout it. Somebody have to shout it. Touch your neighbor and tell him, tell the truth always. No, say it. Jesus. Listen, what do you have then when you don't have the truth? An illusion? What do you have then? A myth? What do you have? Just an illusion. An illusion doesn't change anything. Nothing with reality. And it's above the five senses. What do you mean? When the truth is above the five senses, it doesn't matter what you feel. It doesn't matter your opinion. It doesn't matter how you see things. It doesn't matter. The truth is the truth. This is what many politicians says today. Yeah, but the truth has evolved. Don't turn the TV off, politician. Has evolved. Before, God says, man and a woman. But because the truth has evolved, now it's man and a man. Oh my God, somebody's getting offended right there. Somebody's getting offended. If the truth offends you, you need to say, I receive it, Lord. I don't feel good about this message, but I will receive it. Oh, sorry, bro. Oh, the church, yeah, because we're in the postmodern era. We must evolve. There's a difference between evolving and progressive revelation. But the foundation never changes.
The Bible says marriage is between a man and a woman, period. That's what the Bible says. We're gonna define marriage different now because your politician is evolving. Truth never changes. My God, that's a great amen. A great God. Truth never changes. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter what the doctor said. It doesn't matter what they said. You said, Father, the truth is this. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. The truth is that He will supply all your need according to your riches, to the riches and glory. The truth is, God never changes. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the miracle worker. He is the deliverer. He is the provider. He is God. God brought you this morning to say, God, I will contend for the truth. I will stand on truth. I believe the truth. It doesn't matter what it costs me. I will stand on the truth. Oh, Jesus, something is happening. Is this message reaching your hearts? Or are you living a lie? If you're living a lie, you say, my God, this is a hard message. But stop living a lie. Jesus is coming back, and He wants a church that lives the truth. You want to be committed. You want the blood. You want the Holy Spirit. You want Jesus. You want the power of God. Oh, Jesus. Touch two, three people. Tell them, stand for the truth. Yes, Lord. There are many parents here. You don't tell your children, and you allow sin in your house. You tolerate. They come at 3 a.m. in the morning drunk. They come back and they're watching pornography in your house. In other words, you are afraid to correct them because they think they're going to leave the house. Listen to me. You're already deceived. Because when you correct them with the truth and you say, under my house, these are the rules. I don't allow alcohol. I don't allow things in my house. When you do that, the truth will back you up. Jesus will back you up. He can go for a while, but He will come back. He will come back because God will back you up when you say the truth. God will fight for you. God will stand on your side. Do you want God on your side? Take your seat. Ha, truth. Ha. Why people lie so much? Three reasons. Three reasons people lie so much. One, they're afraid to be rejected. You're applying for a job, and then you said, I got three PhD, PP, and all those pieces. And you don't have three PhDs, but you lie about it. Listen, God, since everything in life starts with the truth. What do you mean? If truth is not in the beginning, it won't work. Why people, they are afraid to be rejected because rejection is painful. If I tell them this, this person will reject me. I'm sorry, but I'm willing to suffer that little pain in order to, for you. I am willing to suffer a little pain, even if you say I don't want you here. It doesn't matter, but I tell you the truth. You need to raise up, generation. You need to stand for the truth. You need to stand when somebody says, oh, you're Christian. Oh, yeah, you're going to be persecuted, even for the seeker-friendly Christian in college. They will say, what is that about the supernatural? What is that? That is that people are foolish in that King Jesus ministry. What is that about? You need to stand and say, wait a minute. I do believe not in a historical God. I do believe in a supernatural God. He has no change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Lift your hands and say, He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You need to stand in your school and say, I'm not ashamed of the supernatural. I'm not ashamed of the Holy Spirit. I'm not ashamed of speaking in tongues. I'm not ashamed to cast out demons. I do cast out demons. I'm a demon buster. I'm not ashamed to claim the blood of Jesus. I'm not ashamed to believe in the Holy Ghost. I'm not ashamed. Somebody have to shout. I'm not ashamed. Say something. I'm not ashamed. You can't be ashamed of the Holy Spirit. We need to contend for prophecy, for the gifts of the Spirit. We need to contend for deliverance. We need to contend to oppressa. Say something. Are you afraid? I have been in countries where I came out in all the newspapers in Italy and Latin America and Africa, and they said, the false apostle, the false teacher, the false prophet. Why am I false? Because I cast out demons, because I make the blind see, because I raise the dead. And religious people hate the supernatural. So that's what they persuade. And I said, okay, let me not to be too strong. I went to Norway. My son over there, Pastor Jan. And then he said, why are you going to be open the conference with, I said, with deliverance? He said, why? Because the Holy Spirit is talking to me. And they're very intellectual. They get offended. Somebody, because they offend their intellect, because we put God in the category of the five senses. If it's something, beyond the five senses, I don't believe it. That's not from God. Who told you that God is limited to your five senses? God is not limited. The basis to me to have something real is not science. I love science and I pray for scientists. The basis for reality is not the trial, it's not the persecution, it's not the opinion of people. The basis where I'm standing and where you're standing is the Word of God, it's the truth, it's the Holy Spirit. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter if you're sick in your body. There is a God. There is a God that loves you. There is a God that fights for you. But you need to stand in the truth. You say, God, I know my finances are not too good because I'm truthful to me. I'm not doing good. I'm not giving. But you know, God, I will be a tither. And God said, I will stand on your side. Oh, Jesus. Somebody have to say amen. I'm finishing. I just give you the introduction. It's the highest type of reality above the five senses. In other words, when you stand in truth, you said, I feel like horrible. But it doesn't matter. The truth says that I'm more than a conqueror. The truth is that that Jesus overcame and defeated Satan on the cross. That's the truth. So what people lies, people lie a lot because they're afraid to be rejected. And number two, they don't want to pay the consequences of persecution because of the truth. In other words, in the times that we're living in, it's very unpopular to be a carrier of the truth. They will mock, they will laugh at you, they will reject you just because you speak the truth. Do not be ashamed to say, I am going to King Jesus ministry where demons are cast out, where the supernatural, where miracle signs and wonders are happening. I'm standing for the truth. Hey, because somebody said, yeah, but the other church is a big church.
You can be a big church and have no reality. There's a lot of churches in America. When I came to the churches and I exposed, because when you are carrier of truth, you're a carrier of something real. When you don't have truth, you don't have a reality. You just have a form of God, no power to change. Can I hear an amen, people? So when I've come into the churches, they rejected me. They say, no, because that's not what the church of God in America is going. Where is it going? We're going into grace. We're going into be seeker friendly. We don't want to offend people. We don't want the things of the Holy Spirit. We don't want the manifestation of the Spirit. We don't want that. Let's entertain this generation. Come on, daughter. Shia. Can I hear an amen, people? So, you cannot negotiate with truth. It doesn't matter what people do. I cannot negotiate with truth. There's people, my friends, pastors, that I love them. When it comes to something and I said, I'm sorry, but that's not the truth. It will be a deception to me to stand in this pulpit and just do a preaching and teaching and never manifest and demonstrate what I preach. I will not be truth to myself. I will be a lying preacher, preaching something that I don't live, that I can't demonstrate. That's a lie. Because I'm afraid that I will offend you. That's where seeker friendly comes. We don't want to offend. We don't want to say this. We don't want to say that. I lost a lot of people in the course of the church for 20 years. People that I love them dearly. I love them. One time there's a person. He used to be the tither, number one tither when I was begin the church. And he said to me, those messages that you're preaching are too strong. He said, if you don't change it, I will leave the church. He gave 25% of the income of the church. We were like 60 people. And I say, I am very sorry. I don't want you to live. I am very thankful to you, but I cannot compromise. And I say, I bless you, go. But let me tell you what happened. All those people that left our ministry because they rejected the truth, now they're in the world, they're in sin, divorce. Because after you reject the truth, the judgment comes. If a prophet comes to you and tells you, there's an area of your life that you need to be changed. James 1:22, I want you to go to scripture. You need to say, Jesus, I need to be. There's a difference between being truthful and the truth. You can be truthful about something, but you're still lying. There's a big difference. I am truthful. Wait a minute. Truthful in your own opinion. Because there's levels of realities. In the world that we're living in today, there is no absolute truth. One scientist called to my television show because I was talking about absolute truth. And I said, science define God according to the five senses. Beyond that, they can't say anything else because they don't know God. And he was so upset. Who are you that you're saying that the science, you're stupid, you don't know what you're doing. And I said to him, okay, I'm standing in something that is beyond you, beyond science. Faith went already to the future. 1960 and 70, they discovered something for the eyes. 2,000 years ago, Jesus already got surgery for the eyes. So that's why you cannot base reality. How many of you want something real? You don't want nothing fake. You don't want to lie to yourself. You have to stand and you say, listen, I'm not committed. I can't lie to myself, but you know what? I need to stand on the truth. I need to serve Jesus. Jesus is coming soon. I need to evangelize. Okay, James chapter 1, verse 22. I'm finishing. Why people are afraid to speak the truth? They don't want to be rejected. Abstain of being rejected. You're the crazy. And then he said, be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. Deceiving yourself. You don't want to be deceived, people. Because when crisis hits your home, you better sure you have the truth in your side.
Come on. Come on.
Can I hear an amen, people?
Amen.
One of my sons came to me. He said to me, he said, Pastor, I was in jail. And they gave me life sentence in prison. And then he said, and then they changed into death row. He said, I was ready. And one time I was preaching here and I said, for many of you that have so many cases, I want you to learn this. And I said, if you know you did it, you better repent and recognize it. Don't ask God for justice because he will give you what you deserve. If you didn't do it, then ask God for righteousness, for justice. But I said, if you did it, ask God for mercy. I said, acknowledge that you made a mistake. Acknowledge that you did it. And repent. That's the truth. And I said, and ask God for mercy. So he started crying out to God. Said, God, I did it. He repented. He asked God for mercy. He went to the courtroom before he went to the natural court. And he repented. He asked God for mercy many times. Suddenly, the Supreme Court denied his appealing. He already had denied his appealing. So no chance to live. He repented. He asked God for mercy because he went with the truth. The judge called him. He said, sir, you know you're about to die. He said, yes, I do. He said, did you do it? Said, I did it, but I repented before God. I acknowledged my crime, but I asked God for mercy. And Mr. Joy, judge, I ask you for mercy. And the judge started weeping. And the judge said, you know, sir, I will release all the sentence. Go home. Now he's part of our ministry. He went with the truth. Come on, come on, come on. Is anybody's gonna stand? Stand when you pray for your business. Don't lie about those numbers. Stand for the truth, and God will pack you up. Thank you, Jesus. Take your seat, and we're finishing. I want to tell you this morning. Many of you got so many things on hold. They're on hold. Why? Because we've been lying so much. And one of the things that grieve the Spirit of God is lying. Stop lying about your age, how old you are, your marriage. Oh, my marriage is so wonderful. Oh, my God, my husband is my princess. Yeah, but you wanted to kill her before you came into church. Guys, if we're troubled, we have to say it. Yes, we do. We do have some problems, but we need to ask for the mercy of God. Today, God will save you from life sentence. God will turn around that business when you repent. God will back you up and heal your body. There's many of you lying to the government saying, I am disabled, and you're not. You need to say, Jesus, I repent. The Holy Spirit of God reveals the truth, and over every eye closed, this is the moment of repentance. Today, in the church today, we don't say repentance. Well, we say, oh, my people have some issues. Yeah, you have sin. Because we don't want to repent. Guys, everything with God starts with repentance. God will start doing something special in you when you say, God, there's some things in my life that are not right. Show me the truth about myself. I don't want to live a lie. I'm not being committed to Jesus. I feel lonely, and I tell everyone that everything is right. I want you to pray as we worship Jesus. And I want you to take 3 minutes. I can't talk to God for you. You need to talk to him. Oh, shit, all right, let's worship. Every eye closed, please. For a moment, let the Holy Spirit reveal the truth to you, the truth about yourself, your spiritual condition, the truth about your family, the truth about what you believe in God. I saw in this election how many people, their faith was shaken because they were more faithful to a political party than the values of God. You want to make sure your values are in the Bible, not in men, not in a doctrine of men. And I want you to close your eyes, because if we die tomorrow, many people are so deceived, they think they're going to go with Jesus. And unfortunately, they're going to stay here. They're not going to go anywhere. And so many people say, yeah, I don't have anything. You're very deceived already. You need to go and say, Jesus, I'm sorry. I don't see the church responding into the message. Father, in the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, every eye closed, please. Lift your hands toward the Lord. Father, revealed. Holy Spirit, revealed. We don't know, even our own heart is deceived. Father, we pray for the Holy Spirit to reveal to each person in this building. Bring conviction into the heart, the God, that we need to stand for the truth, that this generation is deceived. This generation has compromised the truth. That's why in many churches we don't have reality. We just have a form of God, but nothing is happening. Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, reveal the truth into your people. And Father, that we can come out here understanding and knowing that we not keep living the way we keep living. We have to be true, truthful. We have to go with the truth always. And you're gonna back us up. You will be our provider. You will be our healer. Father, truth is a great, is the highest type of reality. We thank you, Jesus. Bless you, people. And let the Holy Spirit reveal into the heart, even those that are watching by the internet. Let the Holy Spirit reveal into the heart. Father, their condition is the result of the truth. You don't have any reality. If you absence of truth, there's nothing. There's just a fake thing in your life. Father, bless you, people. As they repent, as they recognized, as they acknowledge their condition, as they acknowledge in what they've been not doing right. There's some people, the Spirit of God said to me, there's someone here that have done business. And the business you've done it with lies. The Lord said, you need to repent. You can't do business lying. There's people here, you lie about many things. And the Lord said, repent. Repent. See, the truth has to be said in love. The truth has to be said in love, but has to be said. It has to be said. It has to be said. It. Father, in the name of Jesus, pray, Jesus. I don't see people praying. I'm not in a hurry. I'm giving the Holy Spirit opportunity to speak to you. I go to the Holy Spirit. If you want to know my condition, I go to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, speak to me. Talk to me, Lord. Sometimes we kind of like we disfocus. We kind of our mind is something else. We're not in what we just heard. We're just like kind of lost. Can you have the sense of saying, Holy Spirit, speak to me, talk to me? Shombre anda sharabrata, sharabrako sharabakrata, sharabranda shirabranda. Lift your hands toward God. Lift your hands. I am making room for the Spirit to speak to us. Sharabaka sharabakrata, sharaboko sharabakranda. Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you. My life. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I'm not gonna do it like Pilate did, wash his hands and say it. Okay, no, no. But as your spiritual father, I touch the truth. I model the truth. I'm not perfect. I'm not perfect, but I model the truth. I preach the truth. And you know what? I know you will have reality. It's not something fake. It's something that you want, reality. One of the politicians that came last Sunday, he said to me, he said, Pastor, there's a pastor in this city. He said that I met with him many times. And he said, and it was something unusual that after the service, he went with the young people to drink. And he said, because he said he wanted to become like Jesus, like he wanted to become with the sinners. You know, and then he said, it's very strange, is that right? And I said, no, that's not right. But let me tell you, today, to say that in church, even when you say Merry Christmas, people get offended. You have to say Happy Holiday. Yeah. Right? I mean, say it. Why? Because this is freedom. This is a country, we got freedom of speech. But Christians are afraid because they had never been taught to stand on truth. If you're in a school and say, you're Christian, yes, Christian, filled with the Spirit, speaking in another tongue, casting out demons, you have to say it. Why, you're gonna have the backup of God. And he said to me, but that's not right. No, of course it's not right. There's a Friday, what they call Friday church bar. And that pastor, Lourdes, attacked me in the radio. He laughed when people fell on the floor under the power of the Spirit. Now he doesn't have a church. They give him a DUI. No church anymore. You can't play with the things of the Spirit. Listen, the beginning of apostasy starts when you reject the Spirit and the things of the Spirit. Watch out. We're not playing around. Jesus is coming soon. This is serious. There's a pastor, when I went to ORU, Oral Roberts University, this pastor had 5,000 member church. He moved in the power. And I know it's 11:26, but it doesn't matter. You need to hear this. African-American pastor, mighty man. I admire him, respect him, love him. When I was very young in Christ, I saw him ministering, and I said, man, I love that man. I really want to be like that man. And suddenly he started
rejecting the things of the spirit and the supernatural. And then he became ecumenical. He said, everybody's going to go to heaven. But before you believe a lie, God presented you the truth first. So now he got 100 members. He lost the church. And he still believed a lie. People, we live in a very tough times. You can't go over there in anywhere and say, okay, that's God. No, sir. And my job is to protect you and to teach you the truth. Even if it offends you, even if it does, if you don't like it. Can I hear an amen, people? And let me give you something about my finances. Every dollar that I receive personally, every dollar, I tithe from it. Amen. I put it, I take it out, put it in my briefcase. And why? Because I said, how can I tell my people to give the tithe if I'm stealing? A lot of pastors are stealing their tithe.
Yeah.
Pastor, people, that's that you can't be lying to yourself. I'm not perfect. But you need to be, you know what I mean? Yep. Charitin. Let's honor God with our tithe and offerings. I want you to get an envelope. I want you to stay on truth. I didn't get very, I just give you the introduction. Next Sunday, God had been speaking to me and to many men of God, even to Apostle Rene and myself and other men of God, about the transition into the new. How many of you want to go into the new? Touch your neighbor and tell him, I don't want to stay in the past. Okay, next Sunday, listen. Next Sunday, I don't want you to miss 9 a.m. service, because I'm going to be teaching on the transition into the new. End time anointing. There's something new that is coming into your... Before December, I will touch it on Sunday. Please do not miss it, because I'm going to be touching, getting into the new. How many of you want to go into the new? Okay, tonight I will minister miracles. We haven't had a miracle service like Sunday night we did last Sunday, but this Sunday I will be here and I will be ministering. My wife went to Israel with 100 and almost 200 people, but I stay here cooking. I need you to invite me to eat. Okay, get an envelope, please. How many of you are seeing that the money that you're sowing into this ministry is producing fruit with souls? I want to see your hands. And many people ask, okay, where's the parking lot? Where is finished? Where's the studio? It's finished. Do you see how many souls people get saved? Next year, I want the church to come with me in some of my trips. 90% of my trips next year will be Asia and Africa. Only one trip to Latin America, because the Spirit got shifted over there. But this is what I'm going to tell you. I want you to make plan for February. I'm going to be in Ethiopia and Ethiopia, they expecting 2 million people. And I'm going to need people to pray for the people. So please, I want you to speak to Rachel, if you're here. I want you to speak to my mission team. And I want the church to come with me. And I'm going to be in December. I'm going to be in India again. 8,000 pastors in India. So, but this February, I'm going to be in Ethiopia. And I'm going to be in South Africa. I'm going to be in Taiwan. I'm going to be in New Zealand. I'm going to be in Malaysia. So, please come. How many of you want to come with me in one of my trips? I want to see your hands now. Don't lie. No, I'm not kidding. Pastor, what I'm going to do, just, wait. There's a lot of work to do.
Yes.
I put him to pray for the sick. I put him to cast out demons. I put him to be ushers. I put him to take testimony. If you go, you're not going to sleep.
That's right.
Because you think, oh, yeah. And Ethiopia is really a missionary trip.
Yes.
Ethiopia, there's no bathroom over there. So what are you going to do? You're going to do by faith in Jesus. No, no, no. One of my sons in Ethiopia, he's the most influential son in Ethiopia. And my show is being aired in Ethiopia. So he said to me, Dad, everybody knows you in Ethiopia. He said, when I did a miracle crusade, 1 million people came. So we're expecting with you, it's going to be 2 million. Yeah. So I want you to go, guys, and come with me. Yes. Hey, Pastor, what am I going to do? Just pray? No. There's a lot of work to do. Yeah. You can come and cast out demons and pray for the sick and raise the dead and eat rats and, you know. And no, no, that's true, because it's going to be very tough. So we're going to be Malaysia, Taiwan. We're going to be in New Zealand. We're going to be in Jerusalem. We're going to have a supernatural encounter in Jerusalem next year. You're going to come with me to Jerusalem? We're going to have a supernatural encounter in October. So I want you to see, go to my website, and then you see, oh, this is, separate those dates to go come with me. And I want you to come. You know, isn't that awesome to see how many people are coming? 1.5 million people. 1.5 million people in 2016, we haven't finished yet, gave their life to Jesus to our ministry. Tell me, is that real or fake? We're preaching the gospel, and you are part of it. Touch your neighbor and tell them, I'm part of this. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We worship you. Thank you for speaking to us. Lord, we always want to know the truth, even if it offends us, even if it's hard. But Lord, we're not going to reject the truth. We love you. We thank you. Bless your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you shout? Amen. Mentors, Houses of Peace leaders, come up here. Mentors, Houses of Peace leaders, and all the people that are watching by the internet. If you're watching by the internet, you just heard how many people have been touched, delivered, because we're preaching the gospel of the truth. People are being delivered. Thousands of miracles, thousands of healings, thousands of deliverances, thousands upon thousands. So I'm going to ask you today, if you're watching, this is the time to sow. I want you to go to your television screen or to your computer and sow. KingJesusMinistry.org, KingJesusMinistry.org. You can do it right now, and it will take you 2 minutes. So, be truthful to yourself. You want a breakthrough in your ministry and your life and your family? This is the time to sow. Thank you for sowing. Go, take 2 minutes, fill the form, and just take you 2 minutes. Or you said, I want to send a check or money order. You can send it to the address on the screen. Or you can just send a key saying seed, 99-1000, 99-1000, and that's the way you press the button and you give into this ministry. God is doing something new on the earth today. There's something is being released, and you're part of what God is doing. Thank you for sowing. Go right now and say, Jesus, thank you for using this ministry to minister to my heart. In Jesus' name, I love you. Thank you for sowing. Do it right now. Stay connected for tonight at 6 p.m. We're going to be connected, and God will do something powerful. In Jesus' name. Don't get up yet. Don't get up yet. We need to pick up the offerings. Pass the bucket, please. I want you to stay in your seat for a moment. Stay in your seat for a moment. Bow your heads for a moment. Quickly. Quickly, 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 quickly. If you're here today, my friend, quickly, sit down, guys. Sit down. 11 o'clock service, one where they allow people to come in. It's just 9 in service. Stop it. There's a lot of people coming in. I don't want the people here be interrupted. They're receiving. Close your eyes for a moment. If you never received Jesus, if you're here today and you've been doubting, you've been confused what to follow. There's so many gods today being preached. If you never received Jesus, this is what he said. I am the truth, I am the life. Jesus is the truth. Jesus died for your sin. Jesus went to the cross, died for your sin. He went to hell and rose in the third day. My friend, if you're confronting crisis in your life, if you feel sad, if you feel lonely, and you say, I need Jesus, this is the moment to give your life and surrender to the truth, Jesus Christ. If you're here today, if you say, can you pray for me? I need Jesus. I'm going to ask you, everybody's praying. Everybody's praying. If you're here today, say, Apostle, can you pray for me? I need the Lord. I need Jesus. I know Jesus is the truth. I acknowledge the truth. I want you to raise your hands where you are. Please, quickly. The Bible says, one, two, three. Come on, quickly. Quick, lift your hands. Don't be afraid. Are you ashamed to believe in the truth? Or are you going to say, yes, I believe in Jesus? Lift your hands. Come on, quickly. The Bible says, another hand, another hand. The Bible says that there's, God bless you. The Bible says there's two ways that man can go, hell or heaven. God wants you to go to heaven. If you're here today, if you never received Jesus, and you say, Pastor, can you pray for me? I want an encounter with the truth. Lift your hands quickly. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. If you're here today and you say, I was a believer and I went away from God, but today I want to reconcile with God. If you want to reconcile with God, lift your hands quickly. One, two, three, quickly. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. I want you to stand. If you lifted your hands, please stand. Stand, stand, stand. Quickly, quickly. Stand, stand, stand. Come up, come up, come up, come up, come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. Come on, come on. I want to pray for you. Come on, come on. I want to pray for you. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar, people. Can you welcome those people? Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. If you're lifting your hands, come on. Come up to the altar. Come on. There you go. People are coming. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. Come up to the altar. Help, 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 elders. Can you put your hands together, people? We're just going to dismiss the service. Put your hand together. There's more people coming. Come on, there's more people coming. There's more people coming. Your hands for a moment. There's 5,000 people waiting outside. Close your eyes. But I just heard the voice of the Spirit. I just heard the voice of the Spirit. I never finish a service because people are waiting online. I respect them. I love them. And if you're a son and daughter, you will wait. But listen to me. There's a case here this morning. There's a case here this morning. I think there's a woman that have some problems. I think you having the baby, or you got somebody in your family members. I'm not sure, but there's something about your pregnancy that has some trouble having your baby. If you're here today, where's that woman? I want you to come up to the altar, because I think it's a death and life case. And that's what the Holy Spirit said, bring the woman. It's an issue having the baby. There you go, right here. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. One of my elders needs to stand over here already. There's some issues having the babies. I just saw it, right? Okay, but nothing is going to happen, because the Spirit of God loves you so much. They will take care of you. Lift your hands toward Jesus. Can you lay hands on her? Your birth will be okay, but it was a life of death thing. That's what the Spirit of God interrupted. I am so thankful to the precious Holy Spirit. I am so thankful. And we have to yield to Him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Can you pray for her and declare that nothing is going to happen? Let me pray for this couple over here. I saw the presence of God all over you. And I heard the Spirit of God says, you've been crying out to me. And you've been praying and you've been, you put aside your personal agenda. You put aside many things because you want to do my will. And the Lord said, there's so many things the enemy have come against you and races against you. But the Lord's son and daughter, you've been hungry and thirsty for my presence. You are lovers of my presence. And the Lord said, but today, I fill you with my presence. The Lord said, don't despise your age. I have not finished with you. I got a plan to do through you and in you. And that's the reason I brought you here. Because I promise you that I will do something special. I have a call. Even when they're young, even when you get married, you got married because of me, says the Lord. And the Lord said, I will have them finished, and I will do what I promise you. And the Lord said, what you've been crying out for your family, all your family will serve me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Touch him. Fill him. Jesus, touch him. Touch him, Lord. Touch him, Lord. Oh, your love is supernatural. Come on, lift your hands. Come on. Lift your hands. Come on. Always go with the truth. Say the truth. Speak the truth. And tell them, God, I love you. The Spirit of God is so many of you. The Spirit of God is upon you. I bless your son and daughter. I see you tonight at 6 p.m. on a miracle service. God bless you. Give him a big hug to somebody. Look for somebody. Give him a big hug. Give him a big hug. Come on.
Yes, we want to kindly ask everyone if you could please exit to our left.